Right, up next, Clive de Carle, of course. Clive was on my show about 6 months ago now. And again, basically, as soon as the show finished, I got hold of you and said, let's get these guys to talk. I need more for it. The information that this chap is about to give you, when you consider that we're subjected to all these chemical treatments, painkillers and this and that, for everything it gets you from your doctors, and then you listen to Clive, and he comes out with all these different types of remedies that help us that are non-intrusive, it just blows you away. So a lot of research that this chap is doing is going to be putting to us today. The talk, Clive explains what they didn't teach you at school, essential facts like how to have the ideal weight loss, reversing vision loss, the end of tooth decay, restoring the immune system, ending allergies, and much more. So guys, massive round of applause for Clive de Carle. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Briefly, I'll tell you a little bit about myself. I'll start with a story that I wouldn't normally tell, except that we've had all these interesting stories about UFOs and so on. When I was 11, I got taken on a small boat, little dinghy, and it was in incredibly clear water, so you could really see what was going on, and we had a bucket with a glass bottom on it. So you could put the bucket with a glass bottom in the water, and you could see everything crystal clear. And I'd never been fishing before, but I was taken, this was on a fishing trip, and the person I was with, they held the fishing rod, and within seconds, this is in the Caribbean, so within seconds, about 20 fish were attracted to the bait. And he was catching them, every 2 or 3 minutes, catching a fish. He then passed the rod to me. The moment I touched the fishing rod, all the fish, who were quite in a frenzy, suddenly slowed their pace right down and just wandered off. He touched the fishing rod, all the fish came back. I touched it again, they all went away. And I realised that these fish were reading my mind, because he really wanted to go fishing and was really looking forward to eating the fish. I, on the other hand, I'd already had a tremendous battle with myself to impale the worm on the hook. That was really difficult for me. And the idea of having to extract the hook from the mouth of the fish was something I was dreading. And it was weird, because the fish were picking right up on that. They wouldn't have anything to do with me. Anyway, a little while later, when I was about 15, I found myself floating on the ceiling. And this was an extraordinary experience, because I hadn't done that before. And there was a microsecond where my O levels just went into insignificance. And here I am floating on the ceiling, looking down at my dead body. And it's in a very weird shape. And I'm really, I have this instant realization that I am not my body. Because I'm just me, and I'm just the same as I was there, except I haven't got a worry in the world. I'm feeling absolutely great, and I'm floating on the ceiling. Anyway, I'm just really getting into it, when suddenly, bam, I'm back in my body, and I come back to life again. And it was sort of a bit annoying, really. In my early 20s, I studied with a sort of an esoteric society, and they taught me all sorts of things, including how to do hands-off healing, and how to see auras and etherics and all this stuff. And I never did anything with it at all. I went into various businesses. The main one was ophthalmic optics, and I got to see firsthand the inside of operating theatres, and I used to sit in on neurosurgery, actually, and watch people have incredible things done by incredible surgeons who, I have to say, I saw genius at work, absolute genius. You know, if there are certain parts of the medical profession who are incredible. If you've been in an accident, you've been in an emergency, what they can do to fix you is absolutely amazing. They know, for instance, in the emergency room, they know medicine, they don't seem to teach the others. They understand that, let's say, four people come in having a heart attack or a stroke, a good emergency room doctor will know that if you inject them with magnesium chloride, chances are, instead of all four dying, only three are going to die. And that's only one is going to die. Sorry, only one of four is going to die, magnesium chloride. But I spoke, for instance, to a young doctor who was just taking their exams in 4 weeks' time, the final exams. I said, tell me what you know about magnesium. And she looked at me and said, well, I don't really know anything about magnesium, which is a great shame. Let me tell you what they perhaps could have taught her and what the emergency room doctor knows. Magnesium is the mineral that allows your muscles to relax. Calcium is the stuff that makes them contract. Magnesium allows them to relax. Now, some of you will probably be getting little muscular issues. Could I ask you perhaps to put up your hands, anybody who's getting twitches around the eyes or muscle cramps? Okay, and anybody on top of that who is getting hiccups, that's another sign of a deficiency of magnesium. Now, if you're getting a muscle cramp, this is really serious, because if you had a muscle cramp of your heart, you know, we call that a heart attack. You don't want one of those. It's not good. And so they don't teach doctors about magnesium and it having a role with hearts. They don't teach it. People with arrhythmias, they are also deficient in magnesium. Now, magnesium is perhaps the most important of all the minerals because it makes all the other things work properly. You know, without magnesium, you can't absorb the vitamins properly. Most of the other minerals won't work. And unfortunately, magnesium is missing from lots of the foods. The moment you take a brown food, let's say brown rice, whole grain wheat or whatever, and you take the brown bit out, now you're left with the white rice or the white flour, lots of the magnesium, most of the other minerals are actually gone. And it's a real problem because they've taken magnesium out of everything. You know, I used to think that sea salt was good stuff. Now, 27 years ago or something, I got incredibly ill, and the doctors said, you're type 1 diabetic now, so you can't have any more salt. You've got to really cut down on that. For the next 10 years, I had horrible leg cramps until somebody told me, well, you realize you're not eating enough salt. And I started eating more salt, and the leg cramps went away. Now, at that point, if any of you who are eating table salt, you know, that free-running table salt, just ditch that, use it to defrost the pavement or something. But whatever you do, don't eat it. It's highly refined. So what we think of as a natural salt is sea salt. So let's say you go into your favorite supermarket. You walk into a supermarket like Defco, and you buy that. Sorry, I've got a list, I can't say anything. You walk into Defco's salt department, and there you'll see salts, and you know, famous names, and they're dry and fluffy and white. Now, that's not sea salt. That's highly refined sea salt, because sea salt is grey and wet. If you pop down to your nearest ocean, dehydrate, let's say, some Atlantic, what you've got is something grey and wet, because it's so full of magnesium, salt from the sea, that, and magnesium attracts water to it, so it will never dry out. Let's say you've dried out your sea, you know, in the wind and the sun, on those sort of salt flats. You've got it, let's say you put it down in the oven. You heat it up, and now it really is dry. Leave it at room temperature, just out in the room, and moisture from the air will rehydrate that salt, so it's always wet. So Defco don't think you want grey wet salt, so they kindly remove the wetness, i.e. the magnesium, and remove lots of the greyness, and you're left with a salt that really just isn't the real deal. It's got maybe a fraction of what it should have. Similarly, Himalayan pink salt, you'd think that that was a healthy salt, but in actual fact what's happened is over the millennia, water, rain has just washed the more soluble minerals out of the pink salt, so it's dry, so there's no magnesium in it. And I saw a mineral assay of a pink salt, and there were basically only 13 minerals essentially left in it. I was really, really surprised by that. Now, what happens if you don't have enough salt is really, really serious. If you don't have enough salt, you can't make stomach acid. And if you can't make stomach acid, you're going to have a whole host of problems. And if you go to the GP, he's going to say, well, you need an antacid, an anti-acid. They would try and say that if you've got acid reflux, for instance, which is a problem brought about by not eating enough salt or they'll say you've got too much acid, when in actual fact the opposite is true. Let's start with the stomach, because it's so important. As you get older, you make less of things. You make less enzymes, you have less strength, you have less of things as you get older, except hopefully knowledge, which you hopefully have more of. But the doctors seem to think you make more stomach acid as you get older, which is contrary to what we know is true. So let's say you do the opposite of what the doctor says. Instead of taking an antacid, you take something like, some nice proper sea salt would be good. And there's a code name for the real salt. It's called Celtic salt. That's how you tell. And so let's say now you're eating more salt, and you eat an extract from the beetroot called betaine. Now, if you take betaine, that is the precursor for hydrochloric acid. So now with salt and betaine, suddenly your stomach's going to be working properly again. And it won't take long until acid reflux has probably gone away. And now, if you're eating salt, salt also provides the mechanism to make the thing that happens after the stomach. It then goes alkaline, and your body makes bicarbonate of soda as the next action after leaving the acidity of the stomach. And to make bicarbonate of soda, you also need salt. So they've been telling us to eat less salt, and they have been, unfortunately, not doing us any favours by suggesting that. Some of you may have heard of Dr. Batman Jelly, who was arrested in Iran 20-odd years ago when the Ayatollah came to power, and they were arresting so many people that he got put into a jail that I think was built for 800, and there was 7,000 in there or something like that, and something like half the population was ill, and he was pretty much the only doctor, and there were no medicines. The only thing he had to give all these ill people, and most of them had stomach issues and food, was they did have very good water there. They also had real salt, this type of grey wet salt that I was talking about. So as he had nothing else, he said to everybody who came to him, drink as much water as you can, eat loads of salt. So 15 months later, they come to him and say, well, we're really sorry, we made a mistake, you can go. And he says, well, actually, I'm doing the biggest experiment of my entire career. Do you mind if I stay in prison for another 6 months? And he wrote a book called The Body's Many Cries for Water. And you go onto his website, and there are literally thousands of people said, you're absolutely right, my high blood pressure or whatever it was just lack of water and I wasn't eating enough salt. I'm not saying salt and water are the cure for all high blood pressure, but it's surprising what salt and water can achieve. Most of us are dehydrated. The scientists say if you're 1% dehydrated, you can tell in an IQ test. They reckon that most of us are 10% dehydrated, 20% dehydrated in certain cases. So how much access to your brain have you got if you're 10 or 20% dehydrated? You know, are you only 80% here? You know, we are mainly water. And it's pretty important stuff. So the type of water you're putting into your body is going to determine the type of cells and the type of brain you're going to have. Now, let's say your car was dirty and you wanted to wash it. Well, you wouldn't want to wash your car in Coca-Cola or coffee or tea or something like that. You want to wash it in water. Now, your cells are expected to be washed in water all the time. You know, your default is to be happy and to drink water. Now, if you don't drink some pure water every now and then, those cells are going to be a bit clogged up. And I can show you a little demonstration I'll show you in a minute. You want to make sure that the... Paul, could you do me a favour? Could you grab a tea bag out of that box? You want to make sure that your cells are... I can do that. Show you. That's brilliant. So, if I put this tea bag in a glass of water, right, it's cold water, so not much is going to happen. But there are things you can do to change water. You can change various aspects of water. You can change the electrical charge of it. You can change the surface tension of the water. Now, these are some minerals, just some simple minerals from the soil, plant-based minerals. And the moment you add a way of getting the stuff out, you can see how much has been drawn out of the tea bag by adding minerals. Now, you want to add minerals to you, because if you add the right type of minerals, all the toxins that have built up over your entire life in your cells can be cleaned. There are natural mineral products that literally go into your cells, hydrate them, now they're absorbing more oxygen, and they exchange the good guys for the bad guys, and it's about the electrical charge. And I'm going to talk a bit more about the electrical charge of our bodies and why this is absolutely vital to health, to know about your electrical charge. We're electrical beings. But I want to just get back to the stomach and eating food. Now, we've been told about, you know, the healthy food triangle, that we should have a basis of whole grain carbohydrates and stuff like that. But what I've noticed is that probably the most addictive of the products isn't heroin or all the drugs, but it's probably wheat. Many of us, unless we've paid attention to it, are finding that we start our addiction in the morning with a wheat product. Then at midday, mid-morning, we have a wheat product, followed by lunchtime where we have a sandwich or a wheat product, and at tea time we have a wheat product, and maybe we have some pasta or pizza in the evening. A lot of people are absolutely addicted to it, and addiction is something that you do really often. It's something you look forward to in advance of it happening. It's something that makes you feel really good while it's happened, and it keeps you feeling happy a little bit afterwards. And carbohydrates, but the grains in particular, are nothing like the ones that our ancestors would have known some time ago. You know, in Roman times, wheat was sort of 12 foot, 14 foot high, and now it's been bred to be 2 foot high because, you know, why wait for it to get that high? They bred it very differently. When I was young, food was different. For instance, cucumbers were sort of curvy shape, and they had viable seeds that if you preserved them, you could grow them and grow new cucumber plants. But now we're fed lots of seedless vegetables, lots of seedless varieties. And those seedless varieties are so weak, they can't even reproduce. And we're expected to believe that we're going to get the nutrient goodness from a seedless grape, as opposed to a big, powerful, proper grape with dirty, great big seeds, in no way. So not only are we being given food that's been poisoned in various ways, but they've changed the nature of food big time. Now, some years ago, I decided to stop everything to start an organic farm. And first thing that struck me when I was in Spain, and the first thing that struck me when I arrived there was that all the trees that were growing there, fruit trees and so on, every single one was different. And I was so used to the English way, where all the apples in the field all taste the same because they're all hybrids, but there, everyone was different. And the guy who was looking at the farm with me told me, oh, well, that's a really good tree, that was awful, that's a really good tree. And it became very clear that there were various things going on. There was the genetics of each type of tree, and it's very important that we try and get hold of some old varieties for our future and plant them. But it was also very clear that there were differences depending from one field to another. The strata of minerals seemed to vary in very small areas. You know, and most farmers, you ask them, you know, which are your good fields? They'll say, well, that's a good field, that's a good field, that part of that field's a really good field. And so the minerals are very different depending on where you are in the world. And because of modern farming techniques, obviously, the minerals that used to be in the soil aren't there. Let me give you an example. The country supposedly with the highest rate of arthritis in the world is Jamaica. The country with the lowest rate of arthritis in the world is Israel. The country with the lowest boron in the soil is Jamaica. The country with the highest boron in the soil is Israel. Now, I used to do business with the Israelis at one point, and I used to ask them every time one of them would ring up, I'd say, do you know anybody who's got arthritis? And now, you ask that of an English person, do you know anybody who's got arthritis, or everybody's going to say yes. Most of them would say, I can't think of anybody. That's because it hardly occurs. Could there be a link with the mineral boron, I wonder? So, the eating food where the minerals have been stripped from the soil. So we're eating very, very empty food, and it's very, very necessary to correct this. And I found this out the hard way 27 years ago when I got ill. I was fit, played a bit of basketball, did all sorts of stuff, and then suddenly I was having real problems walking. And then it was too much for me to do the power steering of the car, and it got too much for me to go to work at all. And one morning I realised I couldn't put my socks on. I didn't have the strength to put my socks on. It was that time I was in hospital. And they shoved me in there for about 3 weeks, and at the end they said, well, we don't know what's wrong, we don't know how to cure it, but we can operate this afternoon. And it just didn't sound right. So I got taken out of there, and I got taken to Patrick Holford, who's now written about 22 books. And Patrick Holford said, look, you don't need the drugs, you don't need the surgery, you need some minerals. And he gave me a huge bundle of minerals and vitamins, and he was absolutely 100% right. And I had arthritis so badly I looked like I was 85 years old. I was a real mess, hot, knobbly bits all over the place. And it took about a year or so, but it all went away. Every single knobbly bit went away, and I was fine. And I realised that the doctors missed a trick. They just hadn't, they're not taught health. We go to doctors thinking that they know about health, but it's not a subject they study. They've no idea. If you want surgery, radiation and drugs, go to a doctor. They're brilliant at that. Or if you've got an emergency, you can go to the emergency room. They're brilliant at that. Shortly after that, a couple of years later, my dad's best friend told me that he'd got cancer for the second time, and he said he'd never survive if we went through the medical profession again, he felt. So he finds Linus Pauling, the sort of father of vitamin C, you might say, in the phone book, rings him up, and Linus Pauling says, take 25 grams of vitamin C a day, and that should sort your cancer out. And with the proviso, you build up slowly. So he follows Linus Pauling's advice, and he's the only person on the planet who ever won the Nobel Prize as one person twice. And he's on his way to the doctor's office for what he fears might be like the last checkup, because he hasn't been taking the chemotherapy, he's still strong and fit. And so he's in New York, he's walking to the doctor's office when six guys mug him. And thinking he's got nothing left to lose, and being a powerful guy, he takes on all six of them. And they run away, and he gets to keep the money. And he gets to the doctor's office, and the doctor says, well, I don't know what you've been doing, but the cancer's gone. And he only died a couple of years ago. He lived about 25 years afterwards and didn't die of cancer. Mm. Now, so I had two things in mind, my own recovery and his, to say, well, actually, hang on. So at that point, I had to go back to work within what I was doing. But when I stopped and did the organic farming, one of the first person I met was this chap who'd retired. He was a doctor, and he explained to me that he used to be the chief surgeon of Ireland, and that whenever possible he'd do his surgery using hypnosis rather than anaesthesia. And he said to me, look, choose your anaesthetist. It's far more important than the surgeon, because it's the anaesthetist that's going to kill you or keep you alive. And he said, but he doesn't like any anaesthetic because there's a risk, there's a percentage risk factor. So he said, look, I just use hypnosis, he said. I put them into a deep hypnosis, and then if I want to test my work, see whether I've reconnected their fingers right or something, I can quickly get them out of hypnosis, say, wiggle your fingers and put them back again, whereas to wait for the anaesthetic to wear off, well, that wouldn't have been possible. So I got quite impressed with that, and then probably forgot all about it, until I was around at a friend's house. And there's a picture of my friend, and he had this knitting needle through his arm. There was somebody else also with a knitting needle through their arm. They were both smiling. And I said, what is that picture about? He said, oh, we went to this hypnosis class. It was a bit of a weekend course. And by 1 o'clock on the Saturday, we were already sticking needles through our arms. And he explained, look, what we did is we gave ourselves a hypnotic command that there'd be no bleeding, no pain, no bruising, no infection. And he said, the one thing I wish I'd given myself as a command was not to feel anything. He said, I don't want to feel pain, but he He said, I hadn't turned off feeling in general. So he said he felt it going through every muscle and sinew as it went through, but it didn't hurt. And then you could take it out, and you could look right through, because you'd stop bleeding. And I said, OK, I want to meet this guy. So it's Mervyn. And you can meet Mervyn. So at that point, I was sort of loosely working with a medical doctor. And so the two of us rented Mervyn for the weekend, and we said, teach us self-hypnosis. And the first time I tested it out on myself, well, this was years ago, before I'd discovered that my migraines, which I was getting at the time, were to do with dehydration. I hadn't worked out that I was dehydrated and getting migraines. Anyway, I had a terrible migraine. I knew from experience I just had to go in a dark room and feel sorry for myself for many hours. And I suddenly remembered I could do self-hypnosis. I hadn't tried it before. So I went through this 30-second self-hypnosis, and boom, the pain stopped, 100%. And I couldn't believe it. You know, how did I do that? I mean, the pain stopped. And I put in the safety clause, which you have to put in when you're doing work like this, which is I put a time limit on it. I said, I want to be free of pain for 2 hours. So I was looking at my watch thinking, well, you know, 2 hours is up. But the pain didn't come back after 2 hours. Because obviously you've got to put a time period in it. Because if I said I don't want to feel pain, and I hadn't put a time limit on it, then I might have bashed my head, not felt the pain, and bled to death. So, you know, pain's an important thing. Anyway, about 3 weeks later, I got dehydrated again, had another migraine. I thought, easy. Me, I can do anything. And so I went through the same procedure, didn't work. So I went back to Mervyn and said, why didn't it work? He said, your subconscious has learned the fact that you know how to do hypnosis now. It's not going to let you do that again, because if you'd said, I want to turn my heart off now, it would have done. And so it's not going to let you, you're going to be cleverer if you want to get into that level so easily next time. But I did get a pretty good insight that, wow, if we can just turn off pain just like that, what can we do? So I started going on courses, learning hypnosis. And it was very, very interesting, because I learned a few really fantastic keys, which I'll tell you a couple. One of the keys of hypnosis is always to talk in the positive, because the reason people fail when they try to give up smoking is the very fact that nobody wants to give up anything. What the smokers want is they want to be free from it. Now, your subconscious can understand the idea of being free from something, but it hates and loathes the fact of giving up anything. So the language that you use with hypnosis is really, really important. That's why, you know, I mean, obviously we all hate to be criticized. So if you say to somebody, if you criticize them, they hate it and a wall's gone up. If you want to get anywhere with somebody, you really want to praise them. And to say to the person that you love, I love you so much when you do it like that. And let them know what you want and not what you don't want. But it was very interesting, because one of the first things I realized that there is a 10-minute technique which can unwind most people's problems. So that if you can put, let's say somebody had problems as a child, if you can put that problem into a short picture, if you can make a 10-second movie about how you were abused or whatever it was, then if you have the capability to do that, and you can put several events all into one bracket, one can literally unwind a problem. And if you want, at the end, I can show you how to do that. It's a useful technique to learn. Digressed with that. What I'd like to do is pass around a little bit of real salt in case any of you haven't had proper dehydrated ocean. Could you take that and put it, if you just tip it out there and then let people take it. If you all need to try eating just a little one grain of salt, because if you haven't real dehydrated ocean, it does taste completely different from ordinary salt. And this thing about salt is dangerous and it's bad for your heart, you'll get high blood pressure. This is true if it's sodium chloride. If it's table salt, it's going to mess you up. If it's salt that's not whole. It's not whole. Real dehydrated ocean, people with low blood pressure, often their blood pressure goes up towards normal. People with high blood pressure often goes down towards normal. But the interesting thing is that I've been studying deaths. Who dies of what? And what have they done? It turns out that people with blood pressure, the 120 over 90 or 120 over 80 is what the doctors say your blood pressure should be. But in actual fact, when you look at the figures as to who survives heart attacks, what blood pressure do the survivors have is the ones that have the higher number of 165 and over, not 120 or less, 165 or over, that survive heart attacks best. Now, doctors assume that all of you are going to have the same blood pressure. You could be 4'3", and I could pick you up in one hand, or you could be a sumo wrestler. It's assumed that you have the same blood pressure. How can this be? Because if you have an extra pound of weight on you, you need about an extra 20 miles of blood vessels to service that extra pound of you. So the bigger you get, the harder the heart has to work to pump the blood round, because you need a good supply of blood everywhere, particularly to your brain. So as you get bigger, you need higher blood pressure, otherwise you're going to have real problems. But the doctors don't seem to take this into account. And so what I recommend everybody to do is to actually start to research yourself. If any of you have got any sort of health problem, there are two magic words, because Google has got the answers to most health problems on page one. If you put in your problem, say tonsillitis, and the magic words, natural cure, I would say that right now, with a lovely free internet, it's all there. The answer to every disease, no matter what it is on page one of Google. It's there. One of the things I've been looking at is how they've been fooling us. Because when you read the papers and you see the media one way or another, you see this kind of stuff, right? Statins are the key to long life. Okay? Now, if I very quickly just dissect this so you can see what's really going on. It says heart pills and exercise will save millions of lives. Okay, that number, millions of lives. Okay, let me just read it very quickly. Wonder heart pills and regular exercise are the magic combination to help millions live longer, say scientists. Keeping fit and active in old age or taking cholesterol-busting statins are both vital for preventing early death. And when the two are combined, it dramatically slashes the chances of dying early by up to 70%, scientists found, after a 10-year study of 10,000 people. So, sounds good so far. Slashes the chance of dying by 70%, 10-year study, 10,000 people. That's pretty good. Experts are already calling for everyone over the age of 50 to be prescribed statins to ward off chronic and potentially fatal conditions, even if the patients are at low risk. They say administering statins to an extra 5 million people would cut heart attacks and strokes by 10,000 a year and save at least 2,000 lives. Well, hang on. Here it's going to save millions of lives, and by the next page, it's already down to 2,000. Where did the other 90,000, etc. go? The pills, which cost as little as 40p a day, are taken by 8 million Britons to reduce cholesterol, etc. Now, 8 million of us are apparently taking them already. Now, bear in mind, they only give them to you if you're 55, I think. That's an awful lot of the old people who are taking statins. And let me tell you what the boss of the trial said. Leader of the study, Dr. Peter Kokinas of the Veterinary Affairs Medical Center in Washington, said unfit and middle-aged and older people would only need to undertake moderate and feasible activity, such as walking or gardening, to achieve greater protection than achieved by statins. So the leader of the study is saying feasible gardening or walking is going to give you better benefit than the statins. So why are we paying 40p a bill for something that we could get by a little bit of walking. But it's all right, because we're not there going to be further down the scale, written by another journalist, is NHS gets £1.40 one drug. A heart pill costing £1.40 a day, they could save thousands of lives every year, and they've approved it. They haven't then bothered with a 40p one on the front page, they've gone with a £1.40 one. That's what you'd be pleased to know. But there's something else. US scientists studied 10,000 men and women with an average age of 60 and diagnosed with a high cholesterol condition, dyslipidemia. Now, just out of interest, have any of you got dyslipidemia? Any of you heard of dyslipidemia? Right, that's a bit of a trick question because it is to do with high cholesterol. But they said at the beginning, you may have noticed, that they tested on 10,000 people for 10 years. But they didn't tell you that they all had dyslipidemia, a thing apparently none of you in the room have ever heard of. So is it applicable to you, that this figure of 10,000 people? And where are the millions of people dying? Anyway, I could go on cutting this to shreds. But it's on the front page of the newspapers. Everybody is going to pretty much believe it unless you're really looking for the flaws in it. So let me point out another way they did it. There was a very interesting cancer study which claimed, it's the Macmillan cancer study, you've probably heard about it, where they said that early diagnosis of breast cancer can mean that women can live 6 years longer. And late diagnosis, it means that, whatever. So, this is how they did it. They took one woman, now she was lucky, she had an early diagnosis only 1 year. So she got diagnosed early. Now she lived another 6 years, and she died on this date here. Now, so they probably did all the things they do with breast cancer in those 6 years of deterioration, she finally died. Now there's woman number two. She didn't go for early diagnosis, so she lived the first 6 years in blissful ignorance, knowing that she didn't have breast cancer, and it was diagnosed late. Oh no, she only lived 1 year. But both of them got the cancer on the same day, and they both died on the same day, but the lucky one who got diagnosed early, she lived 6 years longer. Okay, get the trick? That's how they did it. And they do it other ways. Let's say that we want to work out who of us is going to die of a heart attack. Right, so there are the absolute risk figures. There's the absolute risk that, let's say, 20% of us are likely to die of a heart attack, or we would have been until we got the information about the magnesium and other things I'm going to tell you. But so that would be an absolute risk. One in five of us. Now, a relative risk would be of all of us. Let's say one of us liked eating a pineapple pizza, and none of the rest of us did, but that one person. No, I'm not describing this properly, sorry. An absolute risk would be, let's say that one of you doesn't get the disease and they eat pineapple pizza, and all the rest of you don't. I'm not describing this properly. My apologies. Basically, they compare... I'm going to just... stop that one and start again. My apologies. All of the... whenever you read that when they give you a number, a percentage, you know, 30% chance of you getting better if you take this drug, just look to see whether they say it's an absolute risk or a relative risk, because they lie. And they use relative risks. There may be a 1 in 1,000 chance, but in terms of relative risks, they can play with those numbers, and it can turn out to be 50%. I'm not going to explain it because I'm not doing it well. Let's get back to the stomach, which is where we were before. Now, on your way down, it goes. The food goes right the way through your gut. Now, if you have ever taken a drug from the doctor, particularly the antidepressants, even more so the antibiotics, you will have damaged the natural inhabitants of your gut. Now, they say that we are beings with perhaps 100 trillion cells. There are 10 times that many bacteria in your gut. So we think of ourselves as us, but actually, as the whole body, we're highly outnumbered. And so if you're drinking water with chlorine in it, or fluoride in it, you're going to be decimating the internal flora of your gut. And they say that 85% of your immune system is generated in the gut. And it's not food that gets you well, it's not the minerals and vitamins that get you well, really it's your immune system that gets you well. All those other things allow your immune system the capability to work properly, you know, because we are self-repairing mechanisms. We are normally in perfect health. If we lose our health, there are only really two reasons why that would happen. One reason is that we've become poisoned. Some toxin has got into our body, and so we are not operating properly because that toxin is stopping our metabolism functioning correctly. The other reason is that we have a nutrient deficiency. So if you correct those two things, if you make sure that all of you are getting all the nutrients you need, every single one, and you've got the toxins out, then you should be healthy. That should mean you don't have disease. Because if you just keep focusing on health, then all the diseases should drop away. And so one of the important things to do, therefore, is to correct the flora in your immune system. And you can do that very, very quickly. Now, when this damage gets done, the bully of the situation is the yeast candida. I can almost guarantee that most of you have got a yeast infection. A lot of you will know about it. Some of you might have fungal toenails. A lot of you will know. If you're unsure, you can do a test. When you wake up tomorrow morning, before you even take a sip of water, spit into a glass of water and leave it for 1 hour. At the end of 1 hour, if the spit has floated to the bottom, sunk to the bottom, that's candida. If you're seeing strands coming down from top to bottom, that's candida. If 1 hour later the spit's still floating on the top, like it was originally, you haven't got candida. Now, if you have got candida, this is what to do. Understand that just like cancer eats sugar and sweet things, candida thrives on sugar and sweet things. So it would be a wise idea to stop eating a lot of fruit, stop eating anything sweet, and cut carbohydrates out for a little time. The other thing to do is to take another yeast, which is called Saccharomyces boulardii. And this is an incredible yeast, because what it does is it attacks the outside membrane of candida. So if you take Saccharomyces boulardii and then 3 hours later, well, it wipes out a lot of the candida. Now you've got literally gaps in your gut where the candida used to be. So 3 hours later you take a really powerful regular probiotic, and that fills the gaps. And so if you take Saccharomyces for about 10 days, ideally 3 times a day, followed 3 hours afterwards each time with the good probiotics, it's the best thing I've seen yet to beat candida. But you need full nutrition to beat anything. And I'd like to run through what some of those are. So the first thing is you really need to get your immune system back together again. Now, I don't like buying probiotics because they cost money, and I'm all for making it yourself at home if you possibly can. So how I make my own probiotics at home is I ferment vegetables, and it's so simple, and we as people have sort of lost the art. Let me just remind you what the art is, because it's very simple. Let's say you wanted to pickle onions. Now, most people think that pickling onions involves some sort of alchemy where you pour vinegar onto them and leave them in a dark cupboard, but that's not how you make pickled onions. How you make pickled onions is you get a jar, you get some water, you hold the onions under the water, and they start pickling. Even within a day or two, they'll start tasting pickly, and all you have to do is keep them under water. If a bit of onion popped out up above the water, it's going to go moldy. you can just throw that bit away. It's just like jam. You can get mold growing on the top, but it's not underneath. You just cut. But if you hold vegetables underneath, they will ferment. Now, the reason people add salt usually to the water is that the salt keeps the bad bacteria at bay until such time. So after a few days, the good bacteria are now happily fermenting your vegetables, and they keep the bad bacteria out. But it's worth putting salt in the water. So you don't have to just use onions. You could use any vegetables. And what I do myself at home is I cut up lots of the hard vegetables. I use things like sweet potato, garlic, chili, onion, red cabbage, beetroot, raw beetroot, celery. You can use anything, absolutely anything. The smaller you chop it up, the quicker it ferments. So a typical way to do it is you get a wide mouth jar, and you chop up all your vegetables, put them in, cover it with salted water, and then let's say you could put a saucer on top if it fitted, with a weight on top, just so that you, any way you can to make sure that all the vegetables are underneath the water. And you'd be surprised how nice it tastes in a few days. After about 5 days, so if you just leave it in a dark place, okay, room temperature, after about 5 days, it's tasting ridiculously pickly. You'd be surprised, after a week, it's probably great. You can carry on pickly for any length of time you like. But if you feel that now the pickle's got to just the right stage, you can slow it down just by putting it in the fridge. And on YouTube, there are dozens of fantastic videos showing you all the different methods. But our ancestors used fermentation to keep us alive in winter. Almost throughout the world, that's how your ancestors did it. They would have fermented all the things we like cheeses, yogurts. They would have made pickles and preserves. They would have made beers and wines. And they would have sun-dried or wind-dried hams or whatever it was. So your gut is expecting bacteria. Okay? Because our ancestors were so used to eating fermented foods. You know, at the end of the season, they're not going to throw away all the vegetables. They're going to pickle them and keep them and make sure that, you know, if we don't see vegetables at the end of the spring, that we're all going to survive. So suddenly, everything's changed. Suddenly, we're not getting pickled and preserved products. Even the cheese, you know, unless you're getting unpasteurized cheese, which is easy to get, all supermarkets sell unpasteurized cheese, they have to label it, and lots of cheeses like Parmesan are always unpasteurized. So the way to get these bacteria back are to eat, to hopefully make at home fermented foods. It's no good going for a pickle that's been made in a factory, because they will have pasteurized it so the jar doesn't explode on a hot day in the supermarket. So you've really got to do it yourself. But it's very simple. And you can pickle anything. You can pickle peppers, you can pickle anything you like, and they can look quite colourful in different jars, and you can play about. But you can repair your gut. Also, there are drinks that you can make, and my favourite is kefir, which is spelled K-E-F-I-R. And there are people on the internet who will either sell it to you for almost nothing or give it away, because this stuff grows. There are two types of kefir. There's milk kefir and there's water kefir. I prefer the water kefir. The milk kefir makes a type of yogurt, but I think yogurt tastes nicer. But the water kefir, you can use fruits, you can use sugar, and I've had people who've admitted to me that they've said, I've had diarrhea every day for months, and 3 days on kefir, completely fixed. You can repair your gut very easily. And kefir in Turkish means feel good. And right throughout Europe, they have different names for kefir. In some places, it's called crystal fungus. You know, it's very famous. Nobody knows how it was first discovered. It's been passed down from generation to generation. And if you've got a jar with it, each time you make it, it grows. It's a mixture of bacteria and yeasts and so on, living in a symbiotic relationship. And you very soon have enough to give all your friends. It's fantastic. Tastes quite nice. And the fermentation process for kefir is so fast. So let's say you dissolve some sugar in water, you put in the kefir, it's like jelly-like, leave it in the dark, the lid off. Within about 3 days, it's burnt up most of the sugar, and 3-4 days later it's tasting really nice. It's not really sweet anymore. Then on the 5th, 6th day it'll start turning to vinegar, and the more vinegary it gets, the more therapeutic its effect is. But you can drink a litre of it a day. You start off small. So I'm interested in stuff that costs nothing, and kefir costs nothing to make, and fermented vegetables cost nothing to make. Super keys to health, absolute keys to health. Now, let's talk a little bit about the brain. We discussed earlier, the brain, as you know, is made primarily of water, but the second ingredient, the dry weight of the brain, is cholesterol. 60% of your brain is cholesterol. And so if any of you are still eating low-fat, low-cholesterol products, just stop right away. We used to know the definition of good things. They'd call it the cream of the crop. And 50 years ago, they started demonizing cream and saying cream is bad for you. But the cream is the best. It always has been. There are only two things that rise to the top. The cream and the scum. The problem is that the cream aren't running the place yet. So the first time I really had a real experience of this was a couple of years ago. I started giving talks about high cholesterol foods and how to give them to people. At that point, I was recommending that anybody with Alzheimer's should be given 6 tablespoonfuls of coconut oil every day. And if they're having porridge or something, you put in the porridge. If they're having stew, you put in the stew. You try and find any way you can. And this woman came up to me, or rang me up, and said, well, my mother wouldn't take the 6 tablespoonfuls, but I did manage to give her most days 4 tablespoonfuls. And she said, 2 years ago, I'd given up talking to her on the phone because it was impossible. The Alzheimer's got so bad. And she said, 6 weeks on 4 tablespoonfuls of coconut oil, and she could speak to her mum on the phone again. She credited 2 years reversal in 6 weeks. So what other high cholesterol foods are there that are really good for you? Well, eggs. Egg yolks are the most brilliant brain food out. If I knew something about Alzheimer's, I might suggest to them, well, why don't you eat 10 eggs a day? Okay, all this thing about eggs being bad for you, just like cholesterol being bad for you, you are made of cholesterol. Every cell in your body has cholesterol in it. You can't survive without cholesterol. Without cholesterol, your brain, which should be, if you like, solid, starts looking like a sponge. But the good news is, to some degree, you can rebuild brains. And there's a great book by the guy who fixed me, Patrick Holford, called Optimal Nutrition for the Mind. And if you want to learn about how to boost your minds, I would highly recommend it. Some incredible information there. And so what are the things that you can get your brain back with? Could I ask, how many of you feel that from time to time you get brain fog? I noticed when I started supplementing with iodine that I had a different access to my brain. Whereas I used to and try to think of words and they wouldn't come, iodine freed my brain up significantly. And many, many, many people since I've been recommending iodine have reported the same thing. Now, iodine is something that you want to research personally before you start taking it. Because while it is ludicrously safe, if you went to a doctor and said you were supplementing with iodine, the doctors these days are taught that the right amount to supplement with is in micrograms. But 80 years ago, you'll find that doctors were in some cases giving doses up to a gram. Now, a gram of iodine, a gram of iodine is actually quite a lot. Now, the people who have the lowest breast cancer in the world, supposedly, apart from the primitive tribes who pretty much have none, of the sort of developed world are the Japanese. Now, the Japanese eat, on average, 12.5 milligrams of iodine every day in the form of seaweed. Now, they have the lowest breast cancer in the world. There is a link, a huge link, between all the cancers that are to do with the sex organs and iodine, because iodine is the basis for all your hormones. But if you're eating food that's been prepared with water with fluoride in, if you're bathing in water with chlorine in it, if you're being exposed to bromides, which are in a lot of processed foods, that those displace iodine. And so you need to get all the bad halogens out of your life. And just to be clear about the bad halogens, you know, in World War I, if you wanted to kill a lot of people really cleanly, then chlorine was your gas of choice. It was hugely popular, you know, one gas of the year, several years. And in World War II, fluoride was really popular because Hitler used it in the concentration camps. You know, they wanted a colourless, odourless, tasteless liquid that they could just slip into the water supply. And fluoride was perfect for that. It makes people really docile, do what you want. Makes them compliant, just like bromine does in the First World War, to stop the men getting horny and to make them really compliant and go over the top and get shot back down again. They put bromide in the tea. And we're being subjected to those three big time, and it is super important to get them out. You know, at the very least, you use a water filter. If you've got one built in your plumbing, even better. But if you're going to fill a bath or have a shower, you need a filter there. Now again, if you've got the money, put in an online filter where the water comes into your house. If you don't, not everybody's seen these, you can buy shower heads with a sort of triple filter system in. And they cost about 15 quid. They don't last forever. You've got to replace them every 6-9 months or something like that, depending on your water. But it makes a hell of a difference. And lots of people have said to me, well, you know, not only does the bathroom smell a lot nicer now, but my hair's softer and skin better and so on. And it's very important. You really don't want those halogens in your body, because all your hormones will be made out of them. Yes, there are lots of people in this room whose hormones are being partly made from fluoride. And it explains a lot of issues. One of the big issues that it explains is the epidemic of hypothyroidism, low thyroid out there. Now, it is epidemic, and the reason it's epidemic is because of the chlorine and the fluoride. So it is vital that all of you know how to spot whether you've got it, first of all. Let me go through a few symptoms, because I realised that I had it, and it took me ages to wake up myself. The symptoms can be, it's different for everybody, difficulty losing weight, cold hands and feet, poor, out-of-control body temperatures. If you feel your elbow should have the same feel as the rest of your skin. If your elbow feels sort of not smooth, then that's a sign you've got rough elbows. If you squeeze your skin, now on your lower arm you should virtually be able to touch thumb and forefinger together. Try on the top of your arm, you should be able to do the same. But if it feels very thick at the top of your arm, if you can pinch it together tightly, great. But if it's thick, that's called mucin. And that's this like sticky substance which builds up under the skin. People who've got sometimes bags under their eyes, people start to go puffy around the neck. If any of you, one of the symptoms that I always hated was I could never wear my shirt tight. I absolutely hated it. It turns out that can be a symptom of thyroid problems, because the thyroids are right here. And anyway, I bought a book called Hypothyroidism Type 2 by Mark Starr. And I was knocked dead by this book, because it described me absolutely. You know, I had every symptom going. But it explained why I've been tired for the last 35 years. You know, I'm one of these people who, when I used to go to work every day, I'd fall asleep on the train, I'd fall asleep in the lunch break, I'd fall asleep on the train back. I was completely tired all the time. And that was adrenal exhaustion and thyroid issues. Now I realize that what I should have done is I should have taken iodine, and I should have taken some desiccated thyroid. Now, the vegetarians and the vegans don't like this idea, but traditionally, before thyroid medication, before the patented stuff, doctors 80 years ago would have given you iodine, and they would have given you a little bit of desiccated thyroid from an animal. And I used to be able to buy desiccated thyroid. You could just buy it on the internet. You can't anymore. They've banned it. Just like they've banned melatonin, just like they've banned herbs, all the natural hormones you can't get anymore. But if you go to the doctor, you should be able to persuade them to give you a natural desiccated thyroid. They'll say, oh no, but we've done the blood test and you're negative. Turns out that about 98% of the blood tests for thyroid are wrong. They don't work because the doctors don't recognize the real symptoms. I changed doctors. I went to see my doctor just last week, and I was talking to her about the thyroid tests they're allowed to do. And the ones you want are to measure your free T3 and your reverse T3. I said, can we get that on the NHS? Oh, no. I mean, can't have those. And now that they're managing their own budgets, of course, you're going to be less likely than ever to get anything out of them. But while you still can get blood tests, I would recommend that everybody should have their levels looked at. You know, how are you on energy? If you're low on energy, maybe you should have your iron levels checked. Maybe you should have your B12 levels checked. Everybody should have their vitamin D levels checked. You know, the rate of cancer goes up in November, at its height in November, when people have now been sun-starved. Now, people don't realize that if everybody took enough vitamin D, the chances are they probably wouldn't be able to hardly anything. The figures are outrageous. There have been studies done all over the world, and it shows very clearly that the cancer rate, let's say, from Norway, drops like a stone as you go down to Nigeria, because the more sun people are getting, the less cancer they get, the less heart attacks they get, the less depression they get. It's really about the sun. You know, we're meant to be out there walking barefoot in lots of sunshine. It was only a few generations ago that most of our people would have been farmers, and we would have all been getting loads of sun, and now it's demonized. And the darker your skin color, the more you need that sun. And so in winter, I would say everybody is deficient in vitamin D, unless you're really out in the sun a lot. But even probably if you were naked in December, you wouldn't get enough sun. The doctor that I was mentioning earlier, I was around his house a few years ago, and he was saying how awful it was with the flu, and I gave him 50,000 units of vitamin D. Now, the RDA at that point, I think, was 200 units. I think now they've put it up to 400 units. I gave him 50,000. 3 hours later, he said, you know, I'm feeling a lot better. Now, I'm not saying that that always happens, but the odd thing, it was this doctor 10 years ago who put me onto vitamin D. When I started taking vitamin D, I've never had a cold or flu since. Now, if you really want protection, vitamin D is a really good starting point. And there's no way to know who needs vitamin D and who doesn't and how much. The only way to tell actually is with a test. I used to think that you could overdose on vitamin D, but it does appear now to be very, very, very rare. And so I take 50,000 international units once a week. I'm thinking of upping that to 100,000 once a week. Now, the international units thing is interesting. In the old days, they used to give lots and lots of vitamin D, and they would often give amounts like 20 milligrams of the, I don't want to confuse you, they used to use another type of D2, and they used to give 20 milligrams. Now, if you convert 20 milligrams into international units, that's 1 million units. Now, deliberately, as far as I can work out, changed the system of measurements for vitamin D and a few others, the vitamins, from milligrams to international units. Because 20 milligrams doesn't sound that much, but 1 million international units sounds like a hell of a lot. Because obviously they want you to have lower and lower amounts. That's why they're trying currently to regulate vitamins and minerals, which clearly we're not going to allow them to tamper with. I recommend everybody should be growing all their own food, herbs, at home, because our ancestors kept us alive on herbs, Didn't burn the witches for no reason, they knew a thing or two. And all that information is still there. Strangely enough, Culpeper's, the classic English herbal, is still as relevant today as ever. But recently, while I've always been very, very keen on herbs, I'd always sort of slightly dismissed essential oils. And just recently, I've been forced to discover how incredible essential oils are and how powerful they are. In fact, it seems now, from the research I've been doing, that, let's say, a herb is one times power, that an essential oil of that same herb could be 100,000 times that power. And it's this supercharging of products that I really like. Let me give you another example of how to supercharge a product. Let's say you've got a lentil. Okay, let's say you've got a bag of lentils. Now, I always think that lentils are pretty boring. Very occasionally somebody will cook me something nice with lentils, but I'm always surprised when they do. And but I know they're healthy, and I'll eat them because they're healthy. However, let's say you soak those lentils in water for half a day or a day, and now you strain it off, leave it for another half a day, rinse it, strain it off, leave it another half a day, keep doing that for 2 or 3 days, and now you've got sprouting lentils. Now, whereas the lentil was totally inedible before, if you sprout it for a few days, you just eat it as salad and it's very nice, but you've upped the nutritional factor substantially. It's not like you've doubled it or factor of 10. You might have whacked it up by 5,000 times, conceivably, depending on which mineral and vitamin you're talking about, because you've brought it alive. That dead lentil, the dormant lentil, okay, it's healthy. But a live sprouting thing can crack concrete on motorways. You really are supercharging with sprouted foods. Some of the healthiest of the foods, let's say you wanted some foods that are anti-cancer, you want to be really healthy, broccoli, all the brassicas are really anti-cancer, as are all the onion, garlic, leek families. But you can sprout those. You can take broccoli seeds, for instance, and sprout them. It takes a few days. You can take seeds of all your favorite salad vegetables, from radishes to garlic chives to onions to celery to everything. You can sprout everything. You can have a massive salad from sprouts. Now, this is really important to realize that, let's say you're on the 35th floor of a tower block and you want fresh salad every day, summer, winter, well, sprout them. I bought some seeds the other day, about a year ago. I think I spent £20 on a whole variety of seeds. I reckon they're going to last me about 5 years because I'm constantly growing everything. I've got always two lots of salad going on seeds, so I've got some that are ready now and some are going to be ready in 3 or 4 days. And it costs nothing. I make fresh salads in the middle of winter in my kitchen, and it's costing me a couple of pennies. I really recommend that everybody gets into doing some sprouting. It saves a fortune, very, very healthy. And occasionally somebody says, well, I've got a granny who's 100 and she I want to give her salads, I know it's good for her, but she won't eat it. Okay, if you can juice sprouts, you can turn it from something that granny would never eat into a little glass of something she might drink. It's important to know how to get people back from a serious situation. And there are several serious situations that are worth knowing about. I haven't done it anymore, but I used to carry around cayenne pepper at all times, hoping that somebody would drop down dead of a heart attack. And they never did, and I was pretty quite upset, really. The thing is that there are loads of doctors out there, you look this up on the web, who are saying, well, rather than wait for the defibrillator, or we tried to get them back, but we couldn't. So we've got some cayenne pepper or any super hot chilies. Get a couple of teaspoonfuls, dissolve it in some warm water, sit them up, open their throat, chuck it in. They're not going to care, they're dead. But they do care because when they come back to life, they're really angry. Because you set fire to them. It's the same as giving them a huge electric shock from the inside out. And you'd be surprised, on the internet, it would appear that 99% of them are coming back to life. So there are other things you can do. This one would take some quick thinking, but let's say that somebody had a heart attack, but now their heart isn't beating. They're still alive, and they've got 10, 20 seconds or something. What they do is they cough, and you can cough your way to the emergency room. Each cough gives you a heartbeat. So if somebody literally their heart stops beating, you tell them to cough their way until they get resuscitated.
I need the messenger. Okay, let me go back to Ivy and tell you a little bit how to look at that. Now, you want to paint iodine on rather than drink it. If you've got a stomach upset, you might want to always dilute it in water if you're going to drink it. It's antiviral, antifungal, and antibacterial, so iodine can be very powerful, but of course you can't get iodine in the chemistry anymore, they've banned that. However, you can buy it, luckily, in actually a better form than they sold in the chemists. There are a couple of good forms. The form that I like is this one. It's called Lugol's iodine. This is a mixture of iodine and potassium iodide, which is what they give the soldiers when they're going to be exposed to nuclear war. And because there is nuclear debris in the air right now, and one of the dangerous ones is radioactive iodine, if you take iodine, then if all the cells of your body are replete of full of iodine, the radioactive iodine will not go in you. It literally bounces off. People don't realize that if you want to be as safe as one can be from radiation, this is not going to protect you from plutonium, some of the real nasties, if you have full nutrition, if all the receptor sites for all the nutrients you need are full, you're in a far safer position. So iodine is sort of number one. It's what they gave people after Chernobyl. They gave them zeolite, iodine. So what you want to do with iodine is ideally to paint it on. And I painted on my skin. If you want to take a dose that was the same as the 12.5 milligrams that the Japanese women take, that would be 2 drops. This is 12.5%. Two drops would be a maintenance dose of iodine. That's if you're drinking it with water. But if you're putting it on the skin, you need to multiply that by about 8. So maintenance drops, about 16 drops rubbed into the skin. Although it's not an infallible test, if you think you're low on iodine, it's not infallible, but if you paint some on the skin, it should be there many hours later. But if you're really low, it seems that the skin just sucks it in really fast. And when I first discovered this, I found that within an hour, pretty much all the iodine had gone, and now I've been gone, it takes 8 hours or something to go. So you can build up your levels. Now, it's important to understand that, let's say a woman gives birth to a child and the mother was low on iodine, the kid will be born with a low IQ. And if you're very low on iodine, there's a medical term for it, it's called cretinism, and the child's born a cretin and mentally defective. So iodine is about IQ, that's why I said it lifts brain fog. It gives you access to your brain properly, and many people notice it. But iodine's far more than that. It means your hormones can work properly. Now, iodine is super, super important, and everybody needs it, particularly children. The British government did a test recently on teenage girls. They found, I think, that 48% or something were already showing signs of getting low iodine. And that means that the problems with low iodine are really serious. Birth defects, hypothyroidism, so many serious problems. And I recommend that all of you read up on iodine. On my website, we've written a big article about iodine. And it's so important, everybody needs to know, because it really is a lifesaver. Let me tell you about some of the other lifesavers and how to use them. Oh, just before I finish on iodine. It would be very important not to take too much iodine. So most people who are low on iodine, how you tell is to take your temperature. Okay? And let's say your normal temperature should be something like 98.4. People argue about the number, 98.6, 98.4. But let's say it was 97.6, just 1 degree lower. Okay? That, they say, reduces your immune system by 40%. So if your temperature is 1 degree low, your immune system is compromised 40%. 2 degrees low, you're running really cold temperature, you're supposed to be compromised 80%. So what you want to do, when you wake up in the morning, throw the covers off and wait a couple of minutes before you get up. Take your temperature then, after the heat of the duvet or whatever has just gone off. You want to try and take your real temperature. If you've got a temperature that goes behind the ears, that's great. If you've got a mercury thermometer, that's great. If you've got an alcohol thermometer, they work pretty well. If you've got a digital thermometer, they're not so accurate. Take the test several times. Possibly under the arm might be a good place. If you're 1 degree low, you need to consider, are you hypothyroid? And when you start realizing what the problems of being hypothyroid actually are, and they appear to include heart attacks, all sorts of bizarre things that you wouldn't have thought, it appears that looking after your thyroid is much more important than you would have thought. And there are two ways to do it. One is with the desiccated thyroid. The other is with the iodine. You really need both. But iodine is certainly something that everybody should consider. And I would suggest that 95% of you, of us, are deficient in iodine because of our exposure to bath water. That's just one example. Another really important one, which we mentioned earlier, is the magnesium. Now, there are many types of magnesium. If you go into Holland and Barrett and you buy their magnesium, you'll find that that's usually magnesium oxide. Now, all the magnesiums are great if you want to move the bowels, and magnesium oxide would do that really well, but if you want to get magnesium into you on a cellular level, taking it internally, you can only take so much until it does move bowels. But if you spray it on your skin, it doesn't have an effect on the bowels, and you can take much, 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 much more. And remember, that the reason that people used to go and take the waters, you know, they'd go to the spas and the bars, often was to bathe in magnesium. And, you know, Epsom salt baths, you know, magnesium is such a relaxant. And let me tell you something interesting thing about cancer. In 1931, some very interesting things happened. As I heard somebody speaking earlier, Otto Warburg won the Nobel Prize for his work proving that if a cell is deprived of oxygen, that to survive, it starts burning glucose instead and becomes cancerous. Same year, 1931. So why I say that is, if the doctors say we don't know the cause of cancer, well, where were they in 1931? Why aren't they teaching it now? Also in 1931, the French Cancer Society had a presentation by this doctor who'd been working in Egypt for 30 years, and he explained that Egyptians only got a tenth of the cancer rate of Europeans. But if you took an Egyptian to Europe, within 2 years they got the same cancer rate as Europeans. So what was it? It wasn't the fact they were Egyptian, it was something about the food. After 30 years he worked it out, it was the magnesium. There was lots of magnesium in all the food in Egypt because they weren't, by that time, they weren't still using the modern fertilizers the whole of Europe were using, because the modern fertilizers were stripping the magnesium out of the soil, so the plants were growing without magnesium, hence the huge cancer rate. So is magnesium important? It's important for heart attacks, to stop them, it's important to stop strokes, it's important to stop cancer. It's important for everything, actually. It makes DHEA, which is the most commonly occurring hormone in your body. DHEA allows you to be happy. It allows you to make testosterone. Magnesium is super important, and everybody should be using it. What I would recommend, or how I use it, is after a shower, I just rub it on. Spray as much as you like. There is no such thing as really too much. And some people have said, do you know, I had the best night's sleep ever. A lot of people's anxiety, nervousness goes. It is nice. You know, people notice iodine, they notice magnesium. And if anybody's getting your muscles cramp, let's say it might take a while normally for that to pass, spray some magnesium straight on the muscle cramp and rub it in, it'll stop in a fraction of the time. Another important one are the minerals. These are called fulvic minerals, and these are super important. If you go into a supermarket or something, or even a good health food store sometimes, to buy your minerals, they tend to be metallic minerals, inorganic minerals. But we want organic minerals. Now, what is an organic mineral? It's one made from plants, right? Now, you've seen animals on wildlife programs go mental about, they'll travel hundreds of miles to lick rocks. You know, they search out minerals. You've probably seen that, you know, the animals go to places where they lick the minerals. You know, farmers don't put animals in a field without a salt lick. You know, they're aware that you have to balance of minerals to animals, otherwise they don't work right. So traditionally we would have got that from salt, which is why salt's so expensive. Just to clarify on salt, you know, the word salary comes from the word sal, salt, because the Roman legions were paid in salt. It was considered, you know, more important to pay in salt. If you weren't worth your salt, you died. You know, without salt, we don't do well. It's no surprise that people aren't doing so well health-wise just because they haven't got salt. So, but salt is the inorganic minerals. And it's great, but you can take the organic minerals in this form. Now, the contents of this bottle are about 1 million years old. The contents of this bottle are about 100 million years old. People ask me, should I keep it in the fridge? No, you don't need to bother. Do I have to use it quickly? No. So, where do they come from? They come from one of these special places that they knew about it because the animals used to go there. When you see, it's from soil. And when you see the soil, there are lots of tiny little sparkly, crystally things in it. It's usually mineral-rich soil. And all they do is they dig it up. They get spring water and they soak the soil in spring water for 3 years. Then they drain it off. And it comes out so concentrated as a mineral soup, if you like. There's enough in here for 4 months. So I started reading about forming minerals a few years ago. The Chinese are really into it. And they'll have baths and stuff that they really go for. And I started reading these stories about forming minerals, which just sounded impossible. All these people curing themselves of all sorts of things, and so I started sending off for it. And bottles used to arrive, generally big bottles, some a little bit smaller than that used to arrive. And I'd try each one as it arrived, I'd never feel anything. And then one day, this little bottle arrived, and I woke up the next morning, I felt different. And I really, you know, it takes a lot to make me feel different. You know, some people are really sensitive, I'm not, I need six, or other people might have one, so to speak. But I noticed the difference, I thought, wow. And after a couple of weeks, it was really clear. My body felt so much nicer to be in. It was as though 10 or 20 years had just dropped off me. And I felt great. And I started giving it to everybody I know. And a surprising number of people get a good reaction. Really surprising. And then people who've been on it for a few years have other things to say. Some people say, my hair was thinning. And I've got double the thickness of hair I used to have. Not everybody gets that one. I've had other people, and you might not get that result. I've had other people say things like, you know, that fibromyalgia I've had for 10 years, it's gone. And I'm not saying this is the cure for fibromyalgia, but the thing is, it's completely obvious that all you need is to be low on one mineral, and your whole body can break. Right? So for a lot of people, they've been chronically low on one or more minerals, maybe their whole life. Maybe they just haven't liked beetroot, and they've ignored a whole class of foods, and they've got a deficiency going on. So there are basically about 100 things you need to eat to be really healthy, and about 70 of them are in here. All the trace minerals, the tiny elements, and it's the trace minerals they now believe are one of the big components of longevity, and this is the stuff that cleans the cells. This is the stuff I add into the tea bag. You put 7 drops in a glass of water, a big glass of water, and it's got to be free of chlorine and free of fluoride. Okay, the stuff reacts badly with halogens. So assuming you're filtering your water, you're all right. But I'd recommend everybody take 7 drops of this a day and see if you notice the difference. It's the missing ingredient. This is a big part of what's missing from food. Right, the trace minerals, super important. Let me, because we're in a bit of a rush now, let me go through some of the other super important things. Vitamin D is cheap as chips, ludicrously cheap. I mentioned about the cells of our body having an electrical charge. How can you tell what the electrical charge is of your body at any time? Well, one good way is to take your pH. And pH strips are really easy. You want to be, roughly speaking, 6.5 or over. And your pH makes a complete difference to your ability to heal. If you're, let me give you an example, 500 newly diagnosed cancer clients, cancer patients. The day they tested them, about 460 were running an acid body when we should be running an alkaline body. So you want to make sure that you're healthy, test your pH, find out, because you can't heal with an acid pH. If you have got an acid pH, how do you correct it? Well, one, so get out of jail free cards to use bicarbonate of soda. 2 hours after a meal, take half a teaspoonful of bicarbonate, a glass of water. If you've just eaten a very acidic meal, it's lots of meat and carbs. Bicarb is going to help re-alkalize you. Fulvic minerals actually re-alkalize you. I also recommend a really high quality multi-mineral that's got the zinc and the chromium. Now, anybody who's craving sugar and chocolate, usually that's chromium deficiency, screaming out chromium deficiency. This has got the manganese. If you buy this from a bad supermarket and they put synthetic vitamins in these days, and the synthetic vitamins are poisonous, to put it frankly. You want a high quality multi, you better take nothing than take some of the ones that are being touted. Yeah, if it costs $4.99, run a mile. Okay, there are a few other things I can show you. In here is what we call silver argan gel. The most important of the ingredients in here is silver. Could I just ask you, how many of you know about or have used colloidal silver?
Yeah.
Brilliant. That's almost all of you. That's fantastic. How many of you have got a colloidal silver generator at home? Well, that's pretty good too. You're switched on, you guys. If any of you don't know about colloidal silver, find out. There are lots of people you can ask. To get a good colloidal silver generator, about 160 quid for one that turns itself off. And that's the important thing. You want one that turns itself off, which means it can measure how many parts per million of silver. I've seen people who have been really told they're going to die of MRSA, you know, the lovely flesh-eating disease you pick up in hospitals. I've seen people completely have been with health for 3 weeks with using colloidal silver and a few bits of nutrition. Super, super, super important. Another thing that's quite interesting is there are now quite inexpensive DNA tests you can get done. So anybody who can't figure out why they still can't get well, they've done all the things they've been told to do and they can't figure it out, DNA tests can be absolutely brilliant, as can hair mineral analysis tests. And if anybody needs that stuff, they can get in touch with me and I can explain it. This is a frequency device. This is a Russian device by the Russian space industry in the sort of 80s. Now upgraded. You know, when they put the cosmonauts up there, you know, the Russians had no money compared to the Americans. You know, the Americans, for instance, spent $20 million developing a ballpoint pen that would write in space. You know, the Russians didn't have that much money, so they took pencils. And similarly, they had no room or weight to put medicines in, and they didn't know what they might get ill with. So they designed this, which not only fixes disease and so on, but it actually puts electrons in and stops you getting diseases in the first place. They are reversing blindness now, and this is one of the things that can reverse blindness. There are several very interesting things that are happening, and it's worth understanding that there are several people reversing blindness in the world. If you want to know more about that, I'd recommend you check out a radio program by a guy called Edward Condrot, K-O-N-D-R-O-T, using ozone, using frequency devices, using essential oils. There are a number of ways to do it. For my eyes, I take a high dose of vitamin C, astaxanthin, bilberry tincture, which is, I make myself, which is delicious. I recommend you all make it. I make marigold tea from lutein, and I take everything we've just mentioned, and I saw my vision improve 2 lines on the chart. I can now read the bottom line, which I haven't been able to do since I was in my 20s. properties. So it's worth understanding that you can reverse eyesight issues. And another way to different techniques for different conditions, but for just long and short sight, for a tenner you can buy pinhole glasses. And I put these on my website, and about 2 months later I got a call from somebody that says, God, they really work. It only took me 3 weeks and I was noticing the difference. And since then lots of people say how good they found them. You just wear them 15 minutes a day, and so you might want to read with them, you might want to look in the distance with them, and it takes a bit of effort. If your distance vision is poor, it takes a bit of effort to look through them and focus, but suddenly you remember what it's like. So you don't need glasses when you're using these, but you want to use them in good light, 15 minutes a day, and you can strengthen your eye muscles. Cheap works. Tell you where my research is taking me at the moment, which is towards essential oils. It's very important if you're working with essential oils to understand that there's a big difference between therapeutic oils, which are real, and the ones they sell in health food stores. In America, for instance, you can have an essential oil which says 100% pure. Now, according to the FDA in America, so long as there's 5% ingredients in there, you're allowed to call it 100% pure. And I haven't had time to look into the English regulations, but they may well be the same. So be very careful, because essential oils can be hugely dangerous if they're made as a fragrance type oil. Very difficult to put on the skin, so watch out. But what I'm now discovering is that essential oils can do the most incredible job in healing. Very inexpensively, and it's about frequency. You know, this Russian device puts frequency into the body, but you can do the same with essential oils. And I've used frequency devices, and I've seen people who've been in pain for 40 years come out of pain. It's surprising, and the evidence is there. This particular one is called Scanar, and the company that I deal with is a company called Pain Genie, and I'd recommend that you have a look at the product, because it's super powerful, and there's masses on YouTube about it. A bit of advertising. I have a website which is called ancientpurity.com, and I can give you a piece of paper with the details. And basically, I've tried to get together supplements and useful tools that really work and that are at the best price, because I reckon that 95% plus of all the supplements out there are just not going to do what you want. Most of the companies out there are getting taken over. A lot of the traditional health food companies are being bought out. They're changing their formulas. They're not as strong as they were. But it's down to the quality of the ingredients. And my father used to have a poster on his wall which says, my taste is simple, I just like the best. And actually, the best lasts the longest, and it's worth going for. Now, we've also put a massive information on the website, because I believe that all this information ought to be free, and it's about empowering ourselves. We all need to get a grasp of actually how simple it is. You know, people need to know that their brain's made of cholesterol. You need to tell everybody you meet, because there are people dropping like flies out there for lack of salt, lack of a few essential things, like knowing what to eat. Watch out, by the way, for bread. Okay, they've changed bread entirely. It's not 100% whole wheat like you might think. Almost every bread now is 43% soya if it comes in a packet. Be very careful. Soya is an endocrine disruptor. Mm-hmm. Think of the most famous person who used to tout soya as a health food product. That was Linda McCartney, possibly. She lived to a ripe old age. I think she died of breast cancer, and unfortunately, she probably ate the product, because soya products are an estrogen mimic. Soya milk, for example, used to be thrown away as a byproduct of the manufacturing industry. And it is very unwise to eat unrefined soya. So you don't want to eat soya sausages, you don't want to eat TVP protein, you don't want to eat soya, you want to avoid it like plague unless it's being treated in advance, like the old cultures used to do, by fermenting it, soy sauce, that sort of thing. The other foods to avoid are any type of margarine, even the best ones, they're all poisonous. No animal would eat margarine. You fill a room full of starving rats with margarine, they don't recognize it as food, they'll starve to death before they eat it. And most of the oils, unless it says cold pressed, any oils are going to be very dangerous. That means all Chinese restaurants, all Indian restaurants, the oils that they're using, fish and chip shops, unless they're using lard, which they do here. You want to be really careful because those oils are giving people heart attacks. They're messing people's brains. But all the information is there. I recommend a website, by the way, called earthclinic.com. There's another one called Doctor Yourself. It's a very powerful website for information.
I know this sounds quite flippant, but with alarm clocks at the moment, they're all busting on me. Another friend of mine is having problems with his electrical charge as well. I was just wondering if there's anything that I could take that would prevent electrical equipment from busting on me. And if it's anything to do, I'm sorry, but I've got grade 3 in integrated science, because I've no idea how all of this works.
I got O-level woodwork, so. That's a new one on me, actually. I know several people who can't wear watches because they stop on them. Have you tried sleeping grounded? There are a number of ways to do it. The cheapest way is to get a little bit of wire and stick a thing of metal into the ground outside and run the bit of wire up to your bedroom. And you can get little Velcro straps, but they use them in the computer business because if you're mending microchips, you don't want a static charge, hitting the microchips, you can wipe out the microchips. They sell these little Velcro straps, they're called grounding straps, and so you connect yourself to the ground, literally, or you can connect yourself to the earth socket of a 3-pin plug. Then, if you sleep with that on, you are now connected to the ground. So all the electrical charges are, if you like, just being grounded out through you. So that might do it. If you've got enough money, you can buy a grounding sheet. They sell sheets with silk thread woven into it. Some people notice a huge difference. But do you turn your Wi-Fi off at night? Do that. Turn everything off. Anything wireless, phones. Wi-Fi's turn off.
Sure.
There's no point in having Wi-Fi going through the news. Oh, yes. I don't know if I've got time to run that through. Is there technical sort of there's a book by Richard Bandler called Get the Life You Want. It costs about a fiver, and I think the technique is in there. Richard Bandler is the father of NLP, and that book actually gives away most of the secrets that people pay thousands of pounds for to go on his courses.
Richard Bandler.
Oh, we're talking about soya earlier. Obviously, I've realised about soya now. We've poured all the soya milk down the sink and everything. Not really. I'm interested about corn. If you're a vegetarian, obviously you're looking for some sort of extra protein content or whatever, usually to replace meat.
I was interested in corn as well. And I went on Google trying to find it, trying to find what it is and how and why and is it safe. And I couldn't find anything. I didn't spend spend that much time, but actually I couldn't find the information I was looking for. Well, I'd like to be able to answer that question. I don't know. It is, but how, and is it good, and have they tested it, and I mean, who knows? Been around for a long time.
You mentioned something called kefir, I think it was. And I'm just wondering, is this the same as kombucha?
It's similar,
yeah,
but different.
Oh, well, perhaps I can pick your brains on the details
kefir,
later.
Kefir, I think, tastes nicer, but they're both great.
Uh-huh.
I just wanted to know a bit more about the frequency devices you were talking about.
Yes. Well, there are so many of them. The first one I used was a much bigger one, and I still have that. I have a website called thetesla.pro.com, and one of the machines is on there. Unfortunately, illegally, we're not allowed to say all the millions of things it can actually do.
Is it like the Bobek device or the RSG, whatever it is?
No. It's really Tesla technology. It's an RF frequency generator.
Right.
And this one puts out a frequency of about 450,000 hertz, and I've seen miracles happen. I'll tell you afterwards.
All right, thank you.
What's your thoughts on the hearing therapy?
Well, clearly it works.
So it what was that?
Hearing. Allegedly, Dave, you probably may have come across. Say that when he was 16 or something, he could do a full lotus, and at 40 he couldn't come anywhere close to it after 3 weeks or something on the urine therapy. Every single one of his problems went away, and he could do the full lotus again. All the stuff was stopping him being fully flexible. I think 28 days.
Okay, guys, sorry, we've got to call it out. We've got more time. Thank you very much.
Of stuff with me to sell, so if anybody needs stuff.
Well, I was going to say, it's an opportunity to get two of those barrels of people and you join. Thank you.